Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Southwest Vermont Supervisory Union Act 46 Exploratory Committee meeting. We have 12 members on this committee that is slated to be 14. We still have two open seats. We have 9 members here, so we do have a quorum, so we can proceed. First order on the agenda is to form a committee. The committee has been formed, but the committee needs to elect a chair to run the meetings. So I will solicit any nominations for a chair.
Would you like to be chair?
No.
Any nominations?
I'd like to nominate Jackie.
Okay. Do I have a second to the nomination?
Second.
Okay. Are there any other nominations? I will declare the nominations closed and call for a vote. All in favor of Jackie Crew to be the chair of the Act 46 Exploratory Committee, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions?
I abstain.
Abstains, duly noted.
You want the job.
All right, Jackie. You can still be the chair from there. She has no desire to sit by the cold door.
So we have been here since 3 o'clock this afternoon, and it's freezing on that side of the building, so I'm staying here. So the first thing is steps to be taken for plan going forward.
What's our work plan?
So what's our work plan? Don't look at me. Basically, we've got to put on the table what we think we want to do going forward, what we need to get to move forward. We need to come to some kind of consensus of what we think the finish line is going to be and how often we want to meet.
Should we throw ideas?
Yes.
I think the first thing, I think the problem we've had from the get-go is whatever this final board looks like, goes that far, what should the representation be? I know this would be a sticky point, but we have to have that, what's going to look like, I think.
So what the makeup of a consolidated board?
Board would look like by town, by representation.
Okay.
I agree, that's pretty important. First step, really. Everybody can find something that they agree on, and that seems like a big hurdle.
I agree that that's a big hurdle, but I think we need to decide whether we want to consolidate.
Well, if we don't want to consolidate, why are we sitting here?
Well, because there's a lot of work if you don't consolidate, too.
Yep.
There's alternate structures. There's like 6 or 7 pages in another report of things that we would have to do that are just as difficult as consolidating. Yes, Ed?
I presume that North Bennington still doesn't want to be part of a consolidated district.
It looks to me like there is only one organization that was explained to us by Donna Russo Savage in which we might be able to have a membership.
Yeah.
And that's the Unified Unions District.
Yeah.
There is a possibility in that organization that North Bennington could be included, so I think it's worth our still exploring that.
Okay.
Also, if we decide that we want to go to an alternate structure, then I think there are a lot of things that we might discuss about how that would work. The MUUSD is the only one for which you can get incentive money. I don't know how important that is to the people around this table, but that's the only one for which it's even possible to get incentive money. And in that presentation that she gave, we have to keep in mind that she noted that it is possible that the State Board of Education, in setting up a final state plan, can override our proposal. So we might be doing work for nothing there that's probably not a fair way to represent it. It's possible that it'd be subject to modification later on. However, if we as a community have already voted on it, I think that would be it would be difficult for the State Board of Education to justify much change in that proposal. If the community's voted on it across the district, that seems to me something in our favor if we were to challenge the State Board of Education's rule.
Okay. But just before you explained the North Bennington position, I was going to suggest that maybe we should ask the Department of Education and the State Board of Education if they would accept a plan that allowed North Bennington to withdraw, which would remove at least 100 students from Mount Anthony, and if that happened, would they still consider Mount Anthony to be economically viable and approve such a plan? And I suppose we can still do that, and it would give us an understanding.
100 students would be leaving?
I think in the current enrollment, I don't have it in front of me, but the last enrollment numbers I saw looked like there were about 100 students from North Bennington that were in the middle school and the high school.
That's correct, 150.
Yeah, and if they were removed, that's about 10% of the school population, and I don't know how that falls out economically for district operations, but if the state is going to consider those factors in their decisions, then we should know up front and allow. Now, spend a lot of time on a plan that they're going to ultimately reject because we've come up with something with that could conceivably remove 100 students from
her briefing. My understanding, or the implication I took from that, is that the only way North Bennington will be allowed to leave the union is through the normal process that's described in, I think, 724, whatever the regulation is, which is that we have to vote on it, and then that all districts would have to vote in favor of it.
Yeah, that's how I took it too.
She did not seem to be offering any possibility that there was any shortcut based on reorganizing whereby we would leave MAU.
Jim, we're talking about what our next step is. One of the members said the final board representation and the makeup of the board, if we became consolidated, would be one of the things we'd have to settle first. And another, I said that we need to decide whether we want to consolidate or not, and what kind of structure we would consolidate in. Do you have anything?
I just concur. This is no longer a study group, but exploratory. That part of it, so we have to explore whether we want to merge. We hadn't done that before. So you have to come to that conclusion whether we want to merge. And as far as representation, most everybody, I don't think anybody in Powell wants anything other than what we have now as far as whatever it is, two reps per town rather than the population. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you.
George, do you have anything to say?
Well, the thing that concerns me is that going back to the North Bennington situation, am I the only one that seems to think that the chances of all of these districts voting to let North Bennington remove itself would ever pass? Am I the only one that thinks that way?
No.
I fully agree with you.
It's not going to happen.
No.
It's not going to happen. So for us to sit here and spin our wheels to say, oh yes, North Bennington, Shasbury, Woodford, Bennington, and the rest are going to do it, it's not going to happen.
I agree.
I think we can look at all the different, I guess, go back to what Jackie said, look at the structures, which is a fully merged district, which is straight out. Everybody's under one umbrella. You know, there's one board, all the schools are under. Elementary schools are elementary schools, middle high school, and it's just one group. Mm-hmm. You know, we can look at that is ultimately where we end up. And then you can splinter off, look at the pros and cons, then do the breakdowns of what would be a pull-out school, whether it be an alternative structure of Shasbury, North Bennington, Pownell as elementaries, and BSD as their own, you know, like the different setups. I mean, we have to see the setups and see the pros and cons. You know, and it could range from BSD doing Bennington Elementary Schools in the middle and high school, and all the other structures on the side. I mean, we have to look at all the different possible options.
That's a side by side.
That's a side by side. And we have, I think we have to go through the list. This is what traditional is, this is side by side, this is alternative, this is mud. What's the pros and cons?
Jim, I'm drawing a blank. Is a mud a unified district, the whole district?
Yeah, yeah. Mud isn't really, we've been calling it a mud, but it's, it's a modified union school district.
So it's everybody consolidated.
But what Bruce had pointed out, which was a surprise, I think, to many at that public forum, is when Donna Russo-Savage put up the slide that, showed a structure that allowed that mud preserved for North Bennington school choice pre-K through 6, which was, for me, the first time I was hearing that. So that was encouraging. But as we opened this meeting and referred, before, what this consolidated board makeup is really what it's going to come down. If we continue along that conversation, that's got to be out there, because there, I know we'll have a different opinion from depending on which town you're from. We all know that. We've been kind of dancing around that.
Was there some concurrence at the last couple of meetings that we would let North Bennington try to leave and just see what they
We can force the vote by offering a ballot proposition to our district saying that we will withdraw. If that passes, then all the other districts have to vote within 90 days on that proposition.
Okay. By district, the town, the whole town has
to vote?
Yeah, ballot vote. Yes. Everybody else, yes, in the MAU would have.
So that would be March. You guys
can
do something quick on that.
Well, until we see a reason that really is helpful, and it's not, because first of all there's going to be some recommendations to the legislature to possibly change that structure a little bit, such that many many troublesome merger models might be able to find a little bit easier way for everybody to realize what they want. The second is, in the face of budgeting numbers being put forth by the SU that suggest that all 100 students, as you said, Ed, would not be attending, makes it a little difficult to seek the truth into what the costs actually would be to the Bennington district or anybody else. And we're starting to plug in some numbers, and Bruce has done some good work on that. But we're talking about pennies, potentially, 2-3 cents cost to the greater community for us leaving. And the question is, what benefits might the BSD and or the other outlying districts? What are the positives of that happening? What in what ways might that actually help you all realize something that you currently cannot realize, which is the creation of a new envisioned structure, whether it's the BSD, MAU fold-in model, with outlying districts deciding that they want out too. Suddenly now that the character of the vote to leave MAU could change drastically if once Pownall and Shasbury realized that they too could vote to leave. Again, with the assumption that 85 to 90% of those students would continue to attend the MAU structure, they would automatically then have 7 through 12 choice. North Bennington would suddenly have K through 12 choice, which is what we see. So it's all within the context of what that vote is really about, and what is the information people are receiving prior to that vote. Are they being scared that their taxes are going to go way up? And then for that reason, they're absolutely against it. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's the right way to start a discussion about changing drastically that kind of structure within the SU.
All right, I'm going to call on Dick next. I want to give everybody a chance.
I don't think Woodford has any hope of standing alone very long outside of a merged situation, because it can't be rated as efficient or the ratios can't be made to meet anything the state wants to see. So I think we have to be involved in some kind of merger situation. To put my thoughts on the table about representation, I agree with Jeff, we've got to get it out there, but Mount Anthony's situation has worked very well for a long period of time. It's been legally tested. I don't see why that isn't an easy, accessible situation to start with. And beyond that, it seems like a modified district, modified union,
Mud
with the S, is whatever it is, seems to be one of the things we need to look at, because that does allow North Bennington some options, I believe, without having any drastic measures taken. I don't see any way that Woodford would like to see North Bennington out of Mount Anthony. I can't see those folks voting that way. And Little Woodford could take down the whole thing.
Lori?
I see this from two different sides. I work at Central Office, of course, and I'm a taxpayer in the town of Pownell. So I want us to all be cognizant that there is possible tax reduction if we actually go into a consolidated district. And I can see personally how it would work, because I do work at Central Office. So I just want us to actually work together as a group, get some real theories on the table, as is North Bennington leaving, and if they are, I wish they would go ahead and do a vote sooner rather than later, so that we can either plan on them, not plan on them. And I'd like Shaftesbury to make their decision up if they're staying or going, so that we can actually have a real committee that wants to consolidate and be one district.
You know, the problem with that is, as you said, North Bennington can push the vote. The other communities have to push the vote. If Shaftesbury doesn't have enough signatures to push the vote in 90 days, we end up back in the same place. You know, as George says, the state. You know, somebody has to take from, you know, North Bennington to North Bennington, but who's they collect all the votes in town and make that vote happen? Who's they doing in Shaftesbury? You know, I mean, as part of this committee, if North Bennington, that's what we want, then we have to prepare, as the committee, say, who's they take the lead in your community to push the second vote? I don't have time to do that. I mean, I know there's probably one North Bennington or in Shaftesbury would, but I mean, is George going to collect how many signatures to put a vote on the ballot and get an election? I mean, which person's going to do it in your community?
What is that number? What percentage of voters would that be?
I'm sorry.
The petitions are about percentage of voters. Does anyone know what percentage of voters would be used for this type of ballot?
For some reason, I think in Bennington we have to get 500. For some reason, that just sticks in my mind. I don't know the percentage.
And that's what I think, you know, we should look at.
I'm not sure that if you're asking about putting on the ballot the notion of leaving MAU, I'm not even sure we need signatures.
Well, on all these ballot votes, why don't we ask the superintendent to get legal input on the number of signatures we need to even do this? 500 seems, wow.
Well, I mean, if your petition to put something on a ballot, for some reason, that comes to mind. I don't know. Don, do you have an answer to that?
I don't know. In Townell and Shaftesbury, I don't know.
It's best if we get the legal officially.
We can gather that.
For all four counties.
And
but under the,
I want to go to Don next and give him an opportunity to voice what he thinks.
Sure, Lori, I'm Don. I'm with the Bennington School District. So,
nice to meet you.
In the Bennington School District. So I'm pretty sure that I know the least about all of this of anyone at the table here. I every time I come to these meetings, I feel like the class dunce. But what I did get a strong feeling for previously was that we had the wrong people in the room, in that North Bennington and maybe Pownell felt like they had been snuckered into this, into a study group process. And it felt like what we had to do was get it so that we had people in the room who actually wanted to treat this series of meetings as though we wanted to try to consolidate. And it feels to me like it would be really great if whoever's in this room, if we're spending our time, if we could move directly to the issues of what would it look like to consolidate? Yep. What's the money look like? What's the, you know, proportionality look like? But not, you know, Matthew, I I think you're probably right. There are probably legislative things coming down the pike, but if we're really just going to spin our wheels and wait to see what happens, then let's give it up now. You know, I feel like I'd rather get a group of people that want to try it on. We don't have to buy the coat in the end, but let's try it on and see if it fits.
And we could just pick the two ones, the one where the layered district they pointed out, which is North Bennington's there. What's that going to look like? You know, ultimately that's where we could end up. But what's the board going to look like in this layered model where North Bennington is the side town? And we could work on one option and say, this is it. Let's see what it looks like. So we sit here and do nothing. And in 2 years, the state's going to come and tell us what to do anyway. So.
Don't use North Bennington as a scapegoat for doing nothing, because the point is that we have one vision. The absolute minimal that we'll accept as a community is this consolation prize, which might be the layered system of which we can stay within the district, but we don't get to realize full choice, which we feel our community absolutely needs for its survival. So you can go ahead and at least look at more than one model. You don't need to look at the model that insists that we're there, because I can tell you, when you come up with a proposal and articles of consolidation, we're going to insist that we are advisory as part of that anyway, so that when a vote occurs, we hopefully would vote to not be a part of it. Don't worry about us. That's something we have to worry about, because then we're an orphan district where at the current 46 law states very clearly they cannot force our choice away.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, we know that that's a bit tongue-in-cheek, but the point is, then we will go about doing what we would have to do for them to fit us somehow.
Yeah.
Don't worry about that. Don't use us, you know, because we were asked to come back to this table from the head of the SU board to be a part of this, but really we're here to see you guys do what you say you want to do, which I don't know what that is. You say you want to consolidate, so do it.
Well, as I listen to everybody at the table, you had your hand up, Ed. I'll give you one more time.
I was just going to comment that since we've asked the superintendent to get a legal opinion on the number of signatures needed. It was my understanding from one of the meetings that the North Bennington Presidential Committee could decide that they're going to warn a ballot vote. So no signatures are needed in North Bennington.
That's what I think is the case, but our point is, I don't know that it's to our best interest or to yours even to go through that whole process. We just assume the state at that point just say, oh, this doesn't work. Sorry, North Bennington. You can't be here.
It sounds to me like most people at the table would like to study a consolidated form.
I think we have to. Until something happens, we are going to consolidate, or we have to consolidate.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, no matter what has happened in Shafter, North Bennington, I mean, the end product is the end product. You know?
So the next discussion is, are we going to talk about board representation, or are we going to talk about
Articles of agreement,
fully merged, MUD, side by side, or all of them?
We had a draft from our consultant of articles of agreement, which never got discussed at that. No, it was scheduled for a meeting. It's a draft, and it was a quick draft, so it's, you know, but it could be a starting point that then would drive the discussion on what board makeup would look like.
Does that need to, do you need to decide which of these structures before those articles are written?
Yeah, I think those articles were written for a modified year.
That's what it says.
Yeah.
I assume you all read those. How do you feel about them?
It's a place to start.
Yes, it's a place to start.
How was MAU handled in those articles?
Mm-hmm.
address personal property, curriculum,
So nobody objects.
School closings.
Nobody voices a problem about how MAU operates. MAU, you know, runs half the education in this town, all these towns. So is there any way we just have a simple vote of all the people where it's an MAU format? Each town gets two representatives. Whatever way MAU is set up, we continue that. And then Shaftesbury, Van Elementary, and Howell, they rolled into that. That's pretty simple for me to understand.
Well, MAU set up with four Bennington, two from all the other towns, and one from Woodford. But Bennington would never have the majority of the votes because it's an 11-member board.
Okay, yeah. So whatever way MAU is set up, that proportionality has worked for decades.
You all saw Stu Hurd's editorial or letter in the paper suggesting just that it's a way to protect the small community, but it also, because you have to have a majority of communities supporting something, not just the raw vote.
And as far as Powell,
it does, that's how they
reduce
the waste management district.
Yeah.
Or you can go to CDC and do an at-large, and whoever gets in, which is...
Yeah,
you know, then you're really looking at it's not community, it's really best for the kids. Right. You know, I mean, at large, it doesn't matter if the whole board's from Pownell. If the best candidates for the board come from Pownell, then they look at the whole community.
I think you risk there.
Well,
there are risky things.
I was going to say, I don't think my board will ever.
So, I mean, I think we have to look at those, what's the board set up? I mean, at large is fair for if you're looking at just the kids. If you're looking for community dollars, MAU might be a little better, but what's the pros and cons of the different board setups?
What I'm suggesting is not a final vote, but a pretty rough estimate of what it would look like to say you should go forward and work out all the twists and angles of this.
And as Jackie said, the Bennington board might not go for an at-large, but why? What's the pro?
Or simple, we decide that later. Yeah. We decide, well, right now, a real simple ballot question to everybody, okay? We're kind of being forced into this. Here's what it would look like. Should we go forward and make this something like this work?
What is Bennington's feeling about the MAU model? It seems like they're the ones who have resisted that. That approach?
Well, we always felt that, well, I don't have a problem with the MAU model, personally, because I was on the MAU board and always thought it worked well. But when we started talking about this, we felt that, as a group, that since Bennington has 66% of the population, that we should have proportional
representation
on the board.
Well, so is that a deal?
I can only speak for Jackie Peru. I don't have a problem with the Mount Anthony board set up, but I would not do it at large. They have to be Bennington voters, just like they'd have to be Pownell, they'd have to be Shaftesbury. You'd have to have your representative from North Bank and Woodford.
So, Mr. Sling, how do you feel about it?
I basically agree pretty much with what Jackie's saying on that.
So it's not a deal killer.
Sounds like we got a deal.
Sounds like that might be, at least to begin with,
a
resolution.
It's a real rough structure. We can get people to say yes or no. If they say yes, then we go in with all the details and come out for another vote. Here's the contract, what you call it? Here's the articles of agreement. Here's basically the basic structure. If we get a yes or no on the basic structure, and then the rest we can work on. And that could happen in March.
But it's just George and I speaking.
I understand.
It's just Jim O'Connor. We're all just speaking now, but if we have just a rough thing out there for a vote, have everybody vote yes or no.
Dick?
Yeah.
Article 9 of the original Articles of Agreement had three options, and I think in order for us to vote on that, we had to choose one of those options regarding representation. Proportional, we're all talking about, we know what that is, and at large is what we're trying to avoid, but there's a hybrid at large, which says that the person who is sponsored as a Bennington representative can't be just elected at large, has to be a resident of the town.
That's the hybrid.
Yeah, like that's the hybrid. There's no reason why we can't still recognize Bennington's concern for that, and then the representative would come from Bennington if he chose the hybrid at large pattern.
I misunderstood. I thought the MAU board already was a hybrid.
It is a hybrid.
It is a hybrid.
That is the model that we're talking about.
With how many by district and how many at large? I thought it was five at large.
I don't think any.
None are at large.
None are at large.
I think there's four from Bennington and two from each of the other.
Woodford has one. North Bennington has one. Pownell and Shaftesbury have two. And Bennington has four.
Okay.
Somehow it comes to 11.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Well, who am I missing?
I don't know.
There's MAU, you have one from Pownell, Shaftesbury.
Two from Pownell.
There are two from Pownell.
Two from Shaftesbury.
Yeah, they're not in order by name, so I gotta look at this.
Two from
I think it's two
one
from
Bennington. One from Woodford, two from everyone else, and four from Bennington, it looks like.
Oh, I didn't know.
So it's North two
Bennington
North
had
Bennington.
Two.
It's two, four, one.
Yep.
Who has one?
Woodford.
That's 11, yep.
Yes. Ed?
I think there's two elements to the representation that would raise a concern for people. One is that Bennington might try to do more favorable things for Bennington. Mm-hmm. Since I've been on the MAU board and the CBC board, I've never seen that type of talk or behavior or concern by the board at all. They're concerned entirely with the student population and what is needed. The other concern is that in a consolidated board, you could conceivably think that Bennington would, the Bennington representatives would try to control the tax costs related to it. And I don't know if that's a possibility or not.
That's the concern, I think, is that.
And I don't know how you resolve that.
You mean the way it's structured now, if we did a hybrid with the four, the
yeah,
two,
I'm,
the two?
I'm just raising potential issues.
I mean, Ed,
because you're only.
I mean, my question for Ed, since he's on the CDC, is that at large?
Yes.
And how do you feel the at large works for the CDC? I mean, you sit in a position that not many of us sit in.
I've never seen an issue with representation.
And for the MAU, you feel it works about the same?
Yeah.
I hate to put you on the spot, but I mean,
the
was,
concern
is the
of
CDC hybrid at large, or is it just at large?
At large.
At large.
At the time the CDC was formed, the legislature considered requiring a proportional representation with the other 16 communities that are part of the CDC. And nobody in Montpelier could figure out how to accomplish that. So they simply wrote the Enabling Act to say they run at large. You need, I think, 30 signatures from a community that you reside in to get on the ballot, but everybody in the district, whether they're in Dorset or Reedsboro, Sanford, whatever, gets to vote for every member running for election on the CDC board.
I sat on the MAU board for over 8 years, and it was always, they're all our students.
And
I didn't think about Bennington's budget when I thought about what we needed at the buildings that we were in charge of and what the students needed in their education.
I mean, it sounds like either one of those, MAU or an at-large, seems to work pretty well.
Yeah, I think both of them work.
Hybrid at large, yeah.
Hybrid at large. And I mean, it seems proportionality, which Bennington would get 6, Shaftesbury gets 1.2, Pownell gets whatever they get that percentage-wise, just seems silly. Because, you know, that's to come down to the fight. You know, people are in field that with Bennington, with their
more than 50% vote are going to try to run the show. So I mean, I think we have to look at, you know, we come down to really two board models, which I think, you know, I mean, Jack says MAU works good. I mean, Ed's on CDC and MAU, and he feels they both work pretty fairly for the kids. You know, I mean, it's, I think we have to look at that part of it.
How does this committee do anything right now?
Right, so I think that's the pivotal question, and I think you've already answered it, which is that we got to try something on. And I think what we should try
We've got to try the code on.
We've got to try the code on and move to the next step and see if it still looks good on us, you know? All right, that metaphor is not going to keep working, but if we could try it with the numbers that you talked about that seem to work for MAU and try to draft some articles, then we could be looking at something specific, you know, and we could start then talking about some of the really nitty-gritty stuff.
I would like the people of Powell to have some real simple question put before them. We give up our sovereignty or as a Powell Elementary, which nobody really wants to do, you know, for the quote unquote, you know, for this other thing, which has some medium term advantages for the Talmud and from a tax standpoint. I just would like not just the two of us here deciding it, but so we have this basic structure, put it out there, and see what people think. If you think this is the way to go, then we'll work out the details and come back to you with the real deal.
So, I mean, what we need to do is we need to pick a model, try it on, come up with pros and cons from each town, and then we should have a selling point. I mean, if you look at this, whatever, this layered model here,
right
here, it includes North Bennington. There's going to be two smaller boards. What's it going to look like? Put one forward and work on it. Instead of trying to say, well, which model do you want? Let's just pick one. You try it on. If you start working on it, if it's like, this is stupid, we go back to the drawing board. Let's try another one.
That's basically what the rest of the people in the state are doing. They're picking one. They're going through the study, figuring out what it's going to look like for them. Some of them have scrapped it and went to the side-by-sides or something else.
Right. And Sunderland had a nice chart from last year where these are all the options. These are pros, these are cons, what's it look like? We need to pick one and start. Everybody can sit here and say, well, let's talk about picking one. We're going to not pick one. And that's what we've been doing for almost
the last year. So what does strategy be for your next meeting? That I send the articles of agreement back up to our attorney and say, update this to show what this, because they were drawn by our consultant, not
hybrid
at large board, and then we bring it back in the next meeting for a discussion and vetting of that out. And as you're saying, if that's not where we want to, can't come to an agreement on that, then okay, what model do we look at next?
Get one to comment.
Well, I was just going to suggest we got articles, maybe we don't all have them here, but we could go through this section by section. It addresses pretty much everything we want to do, change some terms here or there. I don't think it's a good idea to send it to the attorney, because there's going to be reasons we can't do something that the attorney thinks.
If everyone's happy with how it's drawn now, we don't have to send it to
anyone. Or we change terms as we go through it, but at least we've got a format we could work with. It strikes me that we're just talking about ideas and nothing's down on paper and there's no order.
So that's the mud. That proposal is the mud.
Yes.
Yes.
That's, and the mud is does qualify for consent?
Yes.
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 But the layer does not.
Yes, it does too.
It does.
However,
too.
I recommend you stay with the MUD, the Modified Union School District, because there's less likelihood that it'll be challenged by the state board than the layer.
Right.
And that is because part of it includes a PK-12 district. Bennington will be hanging out on the edge, North Bennington will be hanging out on the edge as the K-6, and only involved with the workings of the board 7-12. But the others will be consolidated into one board, so they're partially pre-K-12. That's good as far as State Board of Education is concerned. Layered, you don't have that, and I think the odds are that they would come back and strongly advise that you form a pre-K-12 district out of that instead of just the layered structure.
Yeah, we have that fairly a number of times.
So let's try that on. Let's go try this MUUSD thing and see if we can get the hybrid at large worked in there. And I think I'm not prepared to talk about it tonight. I haven't, but I need to go back and read.
I just suggest that it's a process that we could follow at least.
Yeah.
So we get an electronic copy of that?
Can we at least be reminded what the tax incentives are if we decide to consolidate before such and such time?
The only thing, I have to make this statement. The tax incentives are false because they all go away. And then the real cost of education is going to kick in. I don't want to go out there like Stu Herb has been doing, telling the taxpayers that they're going to save all this money when they're not going to save a dime in the end. Because we're going to use the money to do the study, to form the committee, to form the articles agreement and all that stuff. And then in 3 years, the taxpayers are going to be, we saved 8 cents this year, we saved 5 cents this year, we saved 3 cents this year. And then they're going to get hit and it's going to go up 8 cents because that's what education really costs.
Yeah, I just want to point, I've been reading other articles of, you know, final reports of different SUs around the state, and a great example of that is the Berry Town, Berry City consolidation, where it was to take effect on FY18, and their projected numbers with incentive and the associated cost savings of what they propose. Their 16 budget, this is is $1.23. Next year, it goes to $1.25. And then in 18, when it implements, it goes down to 119, and the following year it's 124, which is back to higher than it was in 16, and then it's just going up from there because that's what savings.
And
that
really
works out to $100 saved per taxpayer with a $200,000.
I just want to caution everybody that we should not use that as an incentive to get people to vote because it's false. And they're going to be very angry in a couple years when they really have to pay what it costs to educate.
I always support Jackie and Lori. If you just stand back and look at all these mergers, there's no money being saved anywhere. I mean, there's just no money being saved. This is a convenience of management. It's, to quit the words they use at the big meeting, but it's, there's no real dollars in Bennington County here. By merging our districts, there's no one can point to $100,000 a year. There's nothing to talk about. And these the tax incentives are temporary and fleeting. So we're doing this for another reason. We're doing this because I guess we have to. Right? And somebody said it's a better way to go. But at no point have we identified any significant intrinsic cost savings to doing this. The one savings that we do save is we reduce four boards at $5,000 a board, so that's whatever that is.
You get paid that much?
Pardon?
You get paid that much?
No, we all get paid $1,000 and we kick back $500 to the government.
No, that's right. Board salaries is one. The
is
audit.
That's the only thing that goes
well,
away.
Well, audits. You wouldn't have to audit that all those different budgets.
You'd have one audit, but that'd be increased.
But they would jack up the price of the audit.
Right. You would have one less. You'd have a few less note takers for meetings, which I'm sure.
Oh,
you'd
there, yeah. Oh, there you go.
Cut your hours.
You're talking about chump change.
You're talking about numbers.
Yeah.
Because you're still operating the same amount of schools and educating the same amount of students.
Yes.
Wait a minute.
Bruce. Yes,
that is a point I'd like to make here. We talked about the board structure being a very important part of this. There are two other questions that I think are very important that probably are not covered in those articles of agreement, but this is our opportunity to write something in about how we want them handled. One is, do we have a strategy for handling decreasing enrollments within the supervisory district if enrollments decline in the future. We all know demographically that's the most likely case. Are there things that we want to write into the Articles of Agreement about how we want to deal with declining populations? And maybe the flip side of that, another one is, what do we want to do, write into our Articles of Agreement that addresses our school property's role in the individual communities that they serve? In other words, what do we want to do to preserve our schools as public entities within the individual communities that they serve? That's something we can address in this article and these Articles of Agreement that may protect us in the future from losing very important assets within our communities.
Okay. I agree with that.
Yeah. Thank
you. I think it's important to understand that those Articles of Agreement were literally put together in less than a two-week period by the consultant and were by no means meant to be comprehensive. And it was a starting point. And some of the other Articles of Agreement, when you go on to the AOE website and see what other consolidation going forward, they do address a lot of that about
exactly.
You know, what happened. They talk about, you know, the possibility of closing schools and at what time, you know, there's a hold harmless time period for, and a lot of, I've seen that for 5 years, no one can close a school. And we, Renee has just recently completed, got back our 10-year enrollment projection, so we could have that present for the next meeting so you can see our most up-to-date projection of what enrollment's gonna look like. I mean, and it is continuing, gonna continue to go down. Not as dramatically as might see, but certainly seeing them, and not a decline in every community, but I don't have it with me here tonight, but that we just, that could be included in our next meeting, so as we address that article.
Article 4 starts its discussion about school closings and, you know, how we could handle it with votes and stuff. But yeah, we really need to look at that.
As we don't all have copies of this, I think the best way to approach this is to get copies and maybe have a meeting.
Like
maybe have a meeting in a week where we've all read it and can
well,
go point by point.
The modification has to happen first. So can you? Is a week possible on that?
You mean just changing the language about the structure?
Yeah, it sounds like some of this was done rather hastily.
Yeah.
Well.
So.
These are not articles of consolidation. These are. This is just to get us started.
This is a template. So we would, at the next meeting, we would look at Article 1, and we would discuss what we thought we wanted it, and cross off what we don't.
Add A, B, C, D's, and whatever else we can.
Kind of like how the policy committee works.
Yeah.
And I would urge you to look at, there's online
other
50 examples of different pandemics, because there's another 90, but there's 20 good examples of what communities have done or proposed doing. In many cases, they might have put it together and then voted it down, but they're out there. So
also, we all have to think, because no matter how much work we do here, I'll get to you in a minute, Ed, in the end, the taxpayers are going to vote, and they might vote against whatever we decide. So we should be thinking about an alternate plan along the way. Somewhere we should be thinking about it. Ed, and you, George.
I'd like to go a step further. And if we assume that we would or will consolidate, I'd like to know what we would do with the union contracts and whether or not there's a way to consolidate all of them so that all the teachers are in one union and therefore reporting to one superintendent.
That would have to be the case.
That would be automatic.
Yeah.
That's automatic.
I don't know that it's automatic because they're a legally binding document
well,
as they exist.
The teachers no longer exist if they can
The teachers are all in the same union, under the same contract, except for Woodford. The only thing that I would see that would be modified under consolidation is like seniority lists and things like that would have to be worked out because it's within their district, not over everywhere. So there it need to be some modifications in, and of course you are in negotiations with all that. And does that contract, if the entity that that's signed with, and I don't know this answer, does that contract become null and void and then we have to renegotiate a new record? Because the recognition clause lists every single school district,
yeah,
not a consolidated school district.
That's where my question originated. Yeah. Does it, if the Pownell district was dissolved because it's now a consolidated district, does that mean all those contracts are technically dissolved and therefore we're going to have one union contract throughout?
And every time we write a contract, well, the last couple times we've written contracts, especially we were going to open them up for health care, we could say that we need to, that this contract will be in effect to such and such, and if whatever we decide, that this will be, the contract will be in effect to hopefully 2019, we don't have to do this again right away. And then it'll be reopened, but they will all fall under, it can be written that way. We're already looking at it in the Paris negotiations of putting all the Paris under the umbrella.
The issue wouldn't be their compensation or what step they're at or anything, because that's all, you know.
Yeah, that's all, yeah, that's all.
But you're right, the seniority stuff could be a problem. It'd be quite a battle.
Any ultimate savings from a consolidation is going to come from reducing the number of staff within the district. And by having one contract, you could conceivably find efficiencies where a particular teacher is going to be at Pownell for 2 days a week and Shasbury for the other two and so forth. Instead of having three different people.
Did you have something?
Well, the only point I was going to mention is that whenever the meeting is that we should be taking this back to our individual boards.
Yeah.
And maybe that should happen before our next meeting so we know what's going on.
Another month cycle.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, BSD can do it.
Either that or call special meetings.
BSD can do it next week, but the rest of the boards don't meet until after that.
Realistically, I think we should create something.
Keep moving.
I mean, you keep moving, you go back to the board, because you can always, I can go back to the board and say, well, this is what I said at last meeting, and I could have Fran or my board say, we hate that idea, Joe. And then I can come back and say, okay, scratch this.
Similar to how the policy.
Which is exactly the policy. And I mean, I don't think we have to ask the board permission first. You go back and ask the boards. You know, they can always say, nope, don't like it, go back to the drawing board. And Shasbury come back and say, okay, we didn't like this article and what Helen applies to Shasbury at this point, and we rework it, the next staff meeting, you know, and you move forward on what you can move forward on.
We've been appointed by our board to be representatives of the board. We need to move ahead. Obviously, we're not going to ultimately do anything that the board doesn't approve.
And that's the whole idea of the exploratory committee versus the formal committee.
If I'm waiting for five to get back to me on one thing, right? Get nowhere quick.
But this board has no authority other than to bring it back to their full committee. So.
And I think a couple months ago, the Secretary of Education weighed in on these exploratory study committees.
Yeah.
We're not allowed to go back.
If we're the formal committee, which has been disbanded, the formal committee could have had the authority to move forward as an exploratory committee.
We're exploratory.
Right, we're exploratory. Yeah. Okay. So you've got to go back to your board with
it. Dick?
Just one. If you want to talk about contracts, maybe that's a place where you could get a legal opinion. But personally, I'd really like to keep the lawyers out of our discussions until we get some common sense stuff down there, because we're going to be led in a different direction than most of us probably want to go.
Yeah, and I'm just going along here. I think it would be much better for us to have a more complete document to present to each of our boards then try to go through article by article like that. We ought to have a relatively complete draft and we can take back.
I
think we ought to go ahead with that.
I think
okay.
so too, and I'd be willing to.
So schedule the next meeting as a work meeting with that article of agreement.
Yes.
With everyone's, I'll make sure that you get it before that electronically and mark up the copy and. And as Matt suggested, if you want to take the time to go on the AOE website and look at some others that have already been completed, and maybe you see an article that you want added, suggest added, so that.
And you'll see that what he put together was just cut and pasted from
the
ones that he's done. Suggested language from the book from
no
the
one
Vermont
was going back
superintendent.
Square one.
So I guess we need to decide when our next meeting is going to be.
You originally had one scheduled for the 8th of November and one for the 22nd. The 1st is also a Tuesday.
I can't do the second Tuesday of any month.
It's election day.
It is election day and I have a meeting.
Do we need the...
What's wrong with next Tuesday?
I can do next Tuesday if... long as it's set.
Unless people want 2 weeks to sit with us, I get that. And then we can make it a Wednesday or something.
So you're talking about November 1?
Well, that would be next year.
November 1, November 15th, if you want to stay on Tuesdays. And then...
I'm okay with November 1.
I cannot do a November 1.
I can't do November 1.
I can't do a November 1.
No, I can't either.
November 15th, then.
15th. So the 8th is off.
Why do we have to stay on Tuesday?
You don't. You have negotiations usually on Mondays. Everyone else's board meetings on Wednesday, so those days are policies on Mondays. So really looking at Tuesday, Thursday.
What about Thursday the 3rd? How would that work for people?
It's okay with me.
Yep.
Open.
Jim?
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay.
6 o'clock?
6:30, I like.
Yeah, 6:30 is better for me, too.
Yeah.
Okay. Does anybody in the, I'm going to open it up for citizens' comments. Ken.
I would like to see without any changes or adjustments for like the other budget we presented, just take the Bennington budget, Mount Anthony budget, and everything, add them all up, which would be what, six numbers, add them all up, and then take 66% of it and just see how that reflects on what our budget would be under that one board versus what we're paying now. It looked like we'd save money, it looked like we'd spend more money. And I think that could be done in probably 5 minutes, because I'm sure we got a budget somewhere in the computer for each district. Right? I mean, bottom has a budget they're working on. So just take that bottom number, and everybody, don't worry about busing and special ed and all this other stuff. Just take that as a random number and come up and let us know. Because I think, you know, we keep saying, well, you know, the setup of the board, but if you go to the people and say, well, it's going to cost in Bennington, since we're going to be paying 66% spent in Powell and Chapter, and it may come up to, you know, we're going to pay another $200,000, which, what scared me is when we had a meeting before, and one of the administrators mentioned that, let's say two special needs students moved into Powell or Shaftesbury or Woodford or whatever, then the mix would be Bennington paying 66% of those two students. All the extraordinary costs they have and everything. You know, that's a big hit. And, you know, I think that's something else we have to keep in mind. And I know the MAU model works, but it's only for MAU. I mean, everybody else has got their own little budgets as well. And we haven't taken that into consideration. Someone mentioned the MAU representation has been to the Bennington, or the Mount Anna, State Supreme Court here in Vermont. Mm-hmm. It was okay. Well, don't forget one man when vote was gone to the United States Supreme Court.
I don't forget that.
The way it goes, too. So maybe the U.S. Supreme Court has overrided the state courts. But I think it's a good thing to move on. Just don't come meeting after meeting and just talk and get a focus on something and work on it. That's good. But I think that money part is important.
Nelson.
Nelson.
I hear that we keep bringing up the MAU model. I would say that you probably should want to look at the articles and the agreements that were under the MAU today, so you can do a little bit of comparison of what you're trying to create. Versus just taking something out of the air, it might have a lot of the things you already need, which could save you some time. The other thing is that once you consolidate into a single board, the way you really, I think, going to get the outside the communities to buy in a little bit is more of a school choice for all schools, because then they can go to Pownell, they can go to Bennington if they're not living on the border, or vice versa, because then they all feel like they have a piece of that school. If you're going to still keep them single and say only the ones in Pownell can go here, and this is it where the line draws, and they're going to go to Bennington, you haven't consolidated anything. So I think in your articles you need to somehow address that school choice, or be able to be flexible in the lines based on population. Because some towns are going to drop the population, some are going to increase the population. Otherwise, we're going to be building new schools and putting additions on schools in one area that we really all we can do is move a few students around. Because when we talk about consolidation, when you build a school, everybody's going to pay for that new school. So let's find a way to be a little more efficient that way. And on Ken's statement, I guess I would urge people to understand that when you have high special need kids that go out of state, or other words, no matter which town has those, a good percentage of that is paid by the state. So what the difference would be for the increase in a community, and I do agree with Ken, I think it'll be an increase. I don't think it'll be as great as people prospect, because you're spending $185,000 a cent, you don't pay the whole $185,000, a good percentage of that comes back. So you need to sort of somehow equate to how that is. I guess that's enough for me tonight. Thank you all for coming. I'm very glad to see that the discussion's going on and the rest. It's really good, going good, and I like that.
Anybody else? Ken?
Does it automatically, everybody shares in everybody else's debts and costs?
That would have to be written in the articles.
Part of the article. I was wondering, because Bennington just floated a $4.4 million bond to fix our buildings. So mm-hmm. One third of that, like $1 million, would be absorbed by the other districts.
Could be.
It all depends on how the articles are written, Kat.
And does it take into account prior debt versus, you know, then when you're coming in?
Yeah, we would have to. You would
have
to look at prior debt.
Establish that the current debt could still be proportional.
I want to read that closely. Yeah. It says that these districts are abolished. All the assets and liabilities of the districts become the liabilities and assets of the MSUSD. All of them.
That could be the end of it there.
Work on our swimming pool in Powell.
Yeah. Jim, on the
we could put a heating system in this place.
I made a note to dig those out.
Maybe send them around the same email.
Send those to them.
That'd be good, yeah.
Go, fine.
Yes.
They may be with our attorney, so we don't have them in.
The Mount Anthony Articles of Agreement?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like that idea, Nelson. Yeah, I think that's good.
Because that
thinking.
Would be a model.
And also, you know, I don't know if it was your point, Jim, but you know, we are going to have to take this to the voters, and the more it's the easier it is to understand, and the more it's like something people already like, or that at least it's already working for people, the better. So.
I just want everybody. Oh, yes, Ray.
I have one, probably a little bit off the mark question. one of the things that's discussed in all this is the ability to move teachers around or staff around in general from facility to facility. And personally, I'd like to see some examples from the SU about exactly what that would mean, you know, and exactly where it would be beneficial. Since we know that there are, between smaller schools, there have always been some cooperative or staff when, because they couldn't afford to teacher for full time or specialists in particular. So where are we going to benefit? Who's going to benefit? Our kids are hope, I hope, but exactly, I'd like to see some examples of it because it's talked about a lot, but no examples produced.
I'd just like to add that complexity is the enemy of transparency. So we should be thinking about that when we write anything out to keep it as simple as possible.
Mm-hmm. Nelson?
Yeah, I was, Ray brought a good question. I think, again, one of the things this is after is trying to equalize education across schools. Mm-hmm. And what you're looking at, what I see in a lot of the schools is that some math loads are being taught higher than others for science. I think that's the advantage when you share teachers, because you can do something in one school in the morning, do something in another school in the afternoon. With teachers that usually cost you more than, because they have the skill and they've been there a long time, to give us those sort of things. You know, I think society is changing enough that the skill levels that our students need to be approached in a little different way. And I think if we can share some teachers that really have good talents, whether it's language, math, science, arts, all that stuff just helps us if their skill levels are better. But again, somebody has to work out how we shuffle people, whether a teacher will shuffle between schools, all contract stuff that we have to deal with.
I've been thinking a lot about this consolidation since we disbanded, and I just want to make this statement. The schools aren't made of, the school boards do not have any power. We do not, we are not what the schools are, and we have to keep that in mind. The schools are made up of the students and the parents that have students in the school, in the community that surrounds it. So that's what we have to keep in mind when we're doing this study. It has nothing to do with us personally. We are school board members elected, but it's we are powerless.
Can I make a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Sorry, Max.
Watch the meeting notice for the next meeting because I'm not positive that this room is available, but we'll check that. So might have to be in central office.
So the next meeting is next Thursday at 6:30 p.m. and to be determined where.
Did we vote to adjourn?
He made a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And you guys that wanted to get home and watch.